Hey everybody, Johnny Baja. So today I'm going to tell you about the 92 Baja 500. So backing up a little bit, we did a San Felipe 250 pre-run earlier that year and came across our main rival, Greg Rowe. And we ran into him and I go, where did you get that? His pre-running bike, the suspension, the frame, everything looked pretty exotic to me. And I'm like, where did you get that? He goes, here, take it for a ride. So I took it for a ride, came back. Jeff told my brother, take it for a ride. I'm like, man, that thing's pretty smooth. He goes, yeah, man, it's the only way to go. I go, well, where did you get that? He goes, oh, it's a Doug Roll chassis and it's got work shocks and all this stuff. I'm like, okay, cool. Well, guess what we did? We went and contacted Doug Roll. He was a chassis builder for quads and a racer himself, very fast, knew exactly how to build chassis and suspension and everything. And I had gotten to the point where I told my brother that, you know, we spend a lot of money and time coming down here racing in Baja, and it's fun, it's interesting, it's good time, but I wanted more. I want to win. At that time, we were maxing out credit cards. Everything we had went into our racing. And I thought, well, what are we doing this for? If we can't go to win, we're just coming down here having a good time. It's too expensive to have that kind of a good time. So I told my brother, I said, hey, I have no interest in going down here again. Either we go to win, we get the right equipment, or I'm out. And he's like, yeah, where do you plan to get the money for this? I go, I don't know. We have to figure something out. So at that time, we were making castings, the reed cages for FMF racing, and we were able to get parts wholesale through FMF. They would help sponsor us in different ways, and we would trade parts back and forth and things like that. And I called up Donnie at FMF, and I said, hey, this is what we want to do. We want to build a brand new bike, and we want to go for the win. And he says, you really think you can beat Dean Sundahl or some of these other guys? I go, yeah, if we have the right equipment, we'll be competitive. He goes, well, okay, let's do it. He goes, make a list of parts from Honda. Let us know what the Doug Roll frame cost. And I go, it's not going to be cheap. He goes, let's do it. So we did. We got the Doug Roll chassis. Doug showed me how to set up the suspension based on the way we rode. We got all new wheels and tires. We got the same tires that everybody else had, Dunlops. And we were getting serious about this whole thing. We were rebuilding our engines from the inside out 100%. Everything was brand new on this bike. It was just, when we rolled it to the finish, to the starting line, it was, now they would look at our bike like, uh-oh, now these guys have what we have. Now it's game on. So we got a good start on that starting position. You start usually 30 seconds apart, sometimes 1 minute apart, depending. I think back in those days, it was about 30 seconds apart. And so we led that race from the very start all the way up. I think my brother gave that to me up in the Pine Forest, was where I got on for the first time. Bike was running good, first one in, I'm thinking, we're having a good day. This is awesome. Took off, went about 15 miles, started to foul a spark plug, pulled over. I'm just panicked because we'd never led. Overall, we had never led one of these races. And so I'm panicked. I get the spark plug changed. You know, we never again did not have tools that we needed. We always had enough tools. We probably had 6 to 8 extra plugs. The spark plugs, we had everything we needed to keep that thing alive. And so got the plug changed, took off across the desert. That bike was a dream. You could go as fast as you wanted to go and the suspension would soak up anything that you put it up to. I was really impressed. So I went probably about a 50-mile run, gonna hand the bike back off to my brother. At that time, for the very first time, we had radios. We could talk from the bike to the pit trucks. let them know we're coming in, or I'm got a flat, or I need help, or whatever. And things really changed at that time. So anyway, I'm calling, telling my brother, hey, I'm 10 miles out, I'm 5 miles out, I'm coming in. And we're coming. And I get to that pit stop, and they're not there. And about 5 minutes later, they come in. My brother, I don't know how, he gets out. He wasn't dressed. He was in his boxers and t-shirt, like just like I don't know what happened. He was not ready to go. maybe he goes, what are you doing here already? I go, this bike is running so good. This is not what we used to do. This is the new style, the new deal. And I got the bike topped off, got everything looked at. We're dressing him up, getting him all ready to go. Get out of here. And we're still leading at that time. So we lost 5 minutes waiting for him. And then when he gets there, you know, by the time he's dressed and on the bike, probably another five. So we've lost 10 minutes and we're still the overall leader for the quads. So he takes off. I'm thinking, wow, this is unbelievable. So he takes the bike, goes to Villa de Trinidad, up to the Mike Sky Ranch, comes back down and hands the bike back off to me. And I'm thinking, you know, we're having a pretty good day here. So anyway, I get the bike back from my brother. Everything's running perfect. We're still leading overall. We're over the halfway point. I'm heading out from Villa de Trinidad and heading back out to the ocean. Get out to the ocean, working my way up through Catarina and that. And at that point, we're still leading. And I come all the way up to Santo Tomas, which is inland from the coast. I don't know, probably 20 minutes or so. I come in there to hand the bike off to our next rider. And we're still leading overall. So I'm thinking we're having a pretty good day. And we had, back when I got on back at Villa de Trinidad, we had about a 20-minute lead, as it turned out. So I'm thinking we got a pretty good cushion. Well, when I got off in Santo Tomas, we only had a 4-minute lead. And I'm thinking that thing was running very fast, wide open. I don't know how they would make up that kind of time. 15 minutes when both guys are wide open just didn't make sense. But who knows? Anyway, I get on the radio to the next or third rider. I said, you've only got a 4-minute lead. This guy is super fast and he is going to catch you. You go as fast as you can. Don't worry about responding back to me, because we figured it was about 15 miles down the road or so. I go, just go as fast as you can. When you hand the bike off to my brother, my brother's going to take it to the finish. I go, just let him know it's going to be down to the wire at the end. So give it everything you've got. This is what we came here for. When it was all said and done, we lost by a minute and a half. My brother had told me that the guy came around him just probably 5 miles or so before the finish, 2 feet off the pegs, completely out of control. Well, maybe he was in control for the way he rode, but basically that guy wanted it really bad. And we lost by a minute and a half and realized, man, we've got to figure out what's going on here. We almost had that race in the bag overall. So that'll wrap it up for the 92 500. I was pretty disappointed, but very happy how the bike ran and what we were able to accomplish. And the next video, that's the big one. You guys aren't going to want to miss that. Thanks for watching.